You are holy.
Are you Lord God?
privilege to worship you. Maker of the universe, it's an honor just to stand before you.
Today in the house of the Lord. The Bible said, let everything that have bread praise the Lord. Do you have bread? It means if you have bread, you're alive. Amen. And if you're alive, you're supposed to praise the Lord. Amen. Glory to the Lord. Glory be to God. The Lord is good. Amen. The Lord is good. Bless the Lord. We thank the Lord that we can come together in the house of the Lord another time. And we can sing the songs of Zion. We can rejoice. We can share the word of God. We can be encouraged. The reason why we come together is so that we can encourage ourselves in the Lord. We can encourage our brothers and our sisters. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. Bless the Lord. What a wonderful thing. The Bible said how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Are we brethren? Yes. Yes, that's what the Bible said. The scripture calls us brethren. If you're not a brethren, and it means sister in two. We are all in the same family. That is what the scripture is getting across to us here. Doreen, could you try to clean this up for me, please? Amen. We are all in the same family. The Bible says if one member suffer, all the other members, one member, one, you know, one of your finger, just the nail broke and it go close to the flesh. You know, it seems as though your whole body is in pain, but it is just your finger. And we thank the Lord that we are in the same family. Praise the Lord. Amen. We have to work together. We have to unite together. And when we work together, the Lord is going to bless us. Today we will continue in our study of the Word of God. Today we are going to go back into the book of Luke. We finished chapter 6 last week. And today we are going to just pick up in chapter 7 of the book of Luke. We bow heads in prayer. Gracious Father, we thank you for allowing us to be here today. And even as we sing the songs of Zion together, we rejoice in the presence of the Lord. We want to thank you, O God, for your graciousness, your blessings that you have poured out upon us. And God, even as we open up the Word of God another time, we pray that you'll feed us. Feed us with manna from above. I pray for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Pray for the mouth of the Lord, the tongue of the Lord, so I can speak a word in season. Someone that is weary today, someone that is tired today, will be strengthened by the power of your words. Bless us, O God, in Jesus' precious, wonderful name. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you. Praise the Lord. All right. We are continuing in our verse-by-verse study of the book of Luke. And today we are in chapter 7 of the book of Luke. You know, I'll tell you something. You know, sometimes when you study in the Bible, there are some parts that is very exciting. And again, there are other parts that you're just taking your time and going through and there's not a whole lot of excitement. And, you know, sometimes some people, they can't handle parts of the Bible that is not exciting. That's why some preachers, they will pick out parts of the Bible to preach on that have a lot of exciting thing and have people jumping up. But sometimes God just wants us to sit and relax and listen to the Word of God and take it in, true, and what He's given us. We open up to Luke chapter 7. It tells us, now, when He had ended all His saying in the audience of the people, He entered into Capernaum. Now remember in chapter 6, we have what is called the Sermon on the Plain. In chapter 6 of Luke, it is more or less the same sermon that Jesus preached in Matthew chapter 5 to 7. It is called in Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount. And here in chapter 6 of Luke, it is called the Sermon on the Plain. But it's more or less a shorter version of what Jesus gave in the book of Matthew. Because the book of Matthew, it's about two chapters. And in the book of Luke, it's about just under a chapter that Luke gives the discourse that Jesus gave on the plain. So when he finished the discussion on the plain, Jesus, the Bible said, now when he had ended all his saying in the audience of the people, and the audience there is talking about the people listened and the people heard what Jesus was saying. And what I'm gathering here, it is very important for us to listen to the Word of God. We need to listen. We need to take time to listen to what the Word of God is saying to us. The Bible said the Word of God is what? Quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Jesus said to his disciples, now you are clean by the word that I have preached unto you. The word that I declare to you make you clean. The word of God will cleanse us. The word of God will purge us. The word of God will heal us. The word of God will deliver us. The word of God will revive us. God's word is true. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. What do you think God telling us to taste? It's taste the word. Amen. Get into the word. Taste the word. So Jesus, in the audience of the people, when he finished proclaim all of the saying on the plain, the Bible said he entered into Capernaum. Now, Jesus was born in Bethlehem. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in fulfillment of the scriptures. But Jesus grew up, or he was brought up in Nazareth. Jesus wasn't born in Nazareth. If Jesus was born in Nazareth, that means the prophecy concerning Jesus born in Bethlehem in fulfillment of scripture, because of the fact that he was from the line of David. David was born in Bethlehem. So for Jesus to be the Messiah, he had to be born in Bethlehem. He was born in Bethlehem. He was brought up in Nazareth, but he established or set up his ministry in Capernaum. You remember when Jesus, he went back to Nazareth, and because the people know him and they knew that he was the son of Joseph, the son of Mary, they didn't really recognize him, and he couldn't really do a whole lot in Nazareth, and they more or less, like, they cast him out. You remember, they did cast him out. They lead him and they run him up to a cliff. You remember we were studying that? And he wanted us to drop him on top of his head. You remember that? Amen. And Jesus, he passed through the crowd and he went his way. And it is believed that Jesus never went back to Nazareth. Some theologians believe that Jesus didn't go back to Nazareth because of the way that they treat him there. So what he did, he set up his office or his ministry. His headquarters was based in Capernaum. And Jesus performed more miracles in Capernaum than any other place in Bible time. Capernaum was the place that he performed most of his miracles. And here the Bible is telling us in verse 2, and a certain centurion servant. If you remove that word servant, you will get the word slave. And when you talk about servant, this is talking about a slave. I think if we look at it as a slave, we will get it better. And a certain centurion servant. The word is centurion. It's a Roman army officer who is in charge of 100 soldiers. He have 100 soldiers under his supervision. And the Bible is saying here that he have one of his slaves who was dear unto him, was very sick and ready to die. So this man, Roman soldier, army commanding officer with about 100 soldiers up under his supervision, he had a slave who was sick, and this slave was dear unto him, and the Bible said he was at the point of dying. That is not a nice place to be, at the point of dying. And we have to thank God. A lot of people, you know, by the grace of God, reach to the point of dying, and God revived them. God bring them back. You know, if you find yourself real sick, anytime we are sick and, you know, you're sick and you're not responding to medication, doctors don't have a lot to give to help you, and you find yourself survive. If you survive, it means that that is divine intervention. When doctors can't provide medication to help you and you just hang on, and then you find yourself day by day, you know, God caused you to recover. And, you know, sometimes I don't think we thank God enough for these miracles. Sometimes we are sick, and because we didn't see any lightning and any thunder, and it wasn't an instantaneous recovery, I don't think a lot of times we are not grateful to God, and we don't really see that as a big deal. But because of the fact that the healing, like, it comes slowly, as the song says, one day at a time. You know, and I think most of the time when the Lord work in our lives, it's going to be one day at a time, little by little. Hallelujah. You might be sick, and your healing may not be instantaneously, but it comes one day at a time, and the Lord calls you to improve and increase in strength, and you are revived. But anyway, this slave, he was sick, and he was at the point of dying. And here the Bible said, and when he heard of Jesus, the message of Jesus, the miracles of Jesus spread throughout Palestine. When Jesus was on earth, Jesus was the most influential person ever set foot upon the face of this earth. Jesus was the greatest miracle worker ever set foot on the face of the earth. There is nobody greater than Jesus. The Bible says he's greater than the prophets. He's greater than Solomon. Greater than Solomon is here. Greater than Elijah. Greater than Moses is here. Jesus, he was the greatest one ever set foot on the face of the earth. Hallelujah. The greatest miracle worker. So the miracles of Jesus, it spread. And, you know, the centurion, the Bible says he heard about Jesus. And here he sent unto him the elders of the Jews, beseeching him that he would come and heal his servant. This is very unique here, because if you know the history between the Jews and the Romans, the Jewish people don't like the Romans. The Romans, they occupy Jewish territory, and the Jewish soldiers was not loved by Roman soldiers were not loved by Jewish leaders, Jewish people in general, because they were oppressing the Jewish people. They were occupying their land. But here we see that there was a relationship. There was a relationship between this Roman centurion and the Jewish leaders. The Bible said in verse 3, and when he heard of Jesus, he sent unto him the elders of the Jews, that is the elders in the community, beseeching him that he will come and heal his servant. So there must have been a good relationship between the Jewish community and this Roman soldier who had under his command about 100 soldiers. And he was able to call the elders of the Jewish community after they spoke to him about Jesus, or whoever gave him the message about Jesus. And the thing is, the Jewish leaders, they didn't really like Jesus anyway. But here we see they were willing to go to Jesus on the behalf of this Roman centurion. And the Bible said that they were supposed to what? Beseech him. You know the word that beseech? It means to beg. It means to beg him to come and heal his servant. You know, today it seems as though we forget how to beg, how to ask the Lord. And we get into the spirit of demanding. We demand things from God. And some people take it so far as if they command God and they tell God, because they find certain part where, I think it's in Jeremiah, where it said, command me now, something like that. And they interpret that to mean that we can command the Lord. And we can tell God when we want it and how we want it. But brethren, we can't command God. Amen. We have to ask the Lord. The Bible said, ask and it shall be given. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Everyone that asketh, receiveth. Him that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be open unto him. So they came, and they were supposed to beseech him, beg him, that he will come and heal his servant. Brethren, sometimes the Lord doesn't come to heal. You know that? Sometimes the Lord doesn't come to heal. Sometimes we are sick, and the Lord can heal, but he chose not to heal. I know it's medicine that is hard to swallow. It was yesterday, myself, my wife, and sister Walters, we went to the funeral of our beloved sister, Sister Claudette Blackwood. I think we probably know her for about 28 years. I think it's about somewhere around there, 28 years, probably know her. She is a committed, born-again believer, loved the Lord. And for the longest while, struggling with chronic arthritis in her body. And according to what I heard, she took two knee surgeries. Double. Was it two? Two at the same day. Two knee surgeries for arthritis on the same day. And then she had us to take a hip replacement. Was it? Hip replacement. And then on top of that, she had something growing on her brain that giving her seizure. And in spite of all of this, this woman of God continued to serve the Lord. And I remember when we used to be at Woodbine Church when she used to suffer with the arthritis. That is about 28 years ago. We used to pray for her, lay hands on her, lay hands on other people. But it happened that the Lord chose not to heal her. I know it is hard for us to swallow. But the thing is, even though God chose not to heal her, she continued to serve the Lord. Brethren, you know, as I was there yesterday listening to Pastor Taylor officiating over the funeral, and he was asking the question, what do you do when you know that you're sick and God can heal you, but God chose not to heal you? What do you do when you know God can heal you and God chose not to heal you? What do you do when you know that God can deliver you from a financial situation and God chose not to deliver you and you end up losing your house? All of these things. You know, so we are fortunate here in this situation. Jesus went and healed this centurion servant, his slave. You know, closer to home, my brother Philemon, God bless his soul, passed away. Sometime this last week, Thursday, I think, I got the news that he passed away. My brother Philemon, you know, for about 45 years, we all got born again, baptized the same day. I remember it was about six of us from the house, from my family, that baptized on the same day. And my brother Philemon was one of them. And we all baptized the same day. From that time we baptized, loved the Lord, you know, hungry for the things of God. And he, according to my memory, he suffered with sicknesses and disease for 45 years. I remember he, you know, when he was young, just as he got married, he got married in his early 20s, and he started suffering with his chest. And he took surgery on his chest, and always with that chest problem, you know, always had to go to the hospital. You know, they have to put tube to pull things off of his chest and stuff like that. And we pray, he pray, other people pray. And not only that, my brother was a preacher. My brother was a pastor of a church. And as I said, he suffered for 45 years. And during that time, he didn't get deliverance from whatever was affecting him. And God bless his soul, last Thursday I get the call that he passed away. He's in a better place now. I was talking to his daughter, and the daughter said to me, "Uncle, you should see Dad. You should see how he looked. He was just like an old man. He go right down to skin and bones." And the thing is, he keep hanging on to the Lord. He didn't quit. He didn't give up. Brethren, the question is, what are we going to do when healing don't come? It is good when healing comes and we rejoice and we celebrate and we say, "Thank the Lord for healing me." You know, I admire and I look up to our brothers and our sisters. I'm not glorifying sickness, but our brothers and our sisters who are sick and they keep praying and it seems as though they are not getting any deliverance and they keep holding on. They keep trusting the Lord. They keep coming to church. They are still faithful. You know, those are the people, in my opinion, I see them as men and women of faith. Because they're not giving up. They're not quitting. They still trust the Lord. Hallelujah. God have the power to heal them, but God chose not to. And I know a lot of times people can't deal with that. But that is the truth of the Word of God. Hallelujah. So here we see that this centurion, his servant was sick, and they sent the Jewish elders to besiege Jesus so that Jesus will come and heal his servant. And in verse 4, and when they came to Jesus, they besought him instantly, saying that he was worthy for whom he should do this. So here, these Jewish leaders come to Jesus and they start to big up the centurion and saying that he was worthy. You know, I believe in prayer of intercession. I believe that we should have people praying for us and stuff like that. But sometimes it is better if you go to Jesus yourself instead of sending other people. I know in our society, a lot of people like other people to do their work. And, you know, in the church today, most people want the pastors to do their praying. They have a problem and they'll call up the pastor and say, "Pastor, pray for me." But I want to say to you today, it is best that you pray for yourself instead of you calling pastor and telling pastor to pray for you. You do it yourself. You take your request to God yourself. The Bible says we must come boldly before the throne of grace, where we can obtain mercy and find grace to help in times of need. Hallelujah. Oh, glory be to God. I love to get down on my knees and call upon God. Hallelujah. The Bible said, when you call, I will answer you. He said, call. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Yes, we believe in intercession. We believe that we're supposed to pray for one another. But brethren, when you get to know God yourself, when you get to hear from God yourself, nothing the enemy do, nothing the enemy send your way is going to shake you. Hallelujah. This centurion, he sent the Jewish elders to take the message to Jesus in regards to his son. And, his servant, his slave. And they said that he was worthy for whom he should do this. That is where they go wrong. Nobody is worthy. None of us is worthy to receive anything from the Lord. We are not worthy to receive salvation. We are not worthy to receive God's mercy, God's forgiveness. All of these things that the Lord is giving us and showing upon us that we are taking for granted, it is all because of his mercy. The word mercy means that you don't deserve it. We, all of us, deserve to go to hell. Not one of us here have the right to go to heaven. Hallelujah. It's because of the mercies of God why we will end up in heaven. But we all deserve to go to hell. But it is because of the love and the mercies of God towards us. So here these people are saying, these elders of the Jews, you see, because the Jewish people, they believe that works is going to get you into heaven. And the more works you do, and if you do good things, that is going to make you worthy. And this is a very powerful word here, worthy. When you talk about worthy, it comes from weighing or weight. I remember when we used to live in Grenada, we used to have a little shop, and I used to be in the shop weighing stuff. If you want to weigh a pound of sugar or flour, you have to put the flour in the bag, in the tray, and you have the 1 pound weight, and you put it on this side. And when you put the flour in or the sugar in, it will balance itself. And when you reach to the point, it will level off and it's not shaking anymore. It means that it's balanced and you have a full 1 pound. And when the Bible talks about worthy, it is talking about the full weight. And brethren, none of us could give the full weight with where God is concerned. So that's the reason why it is because of the mercies of God. Hallelujah. None of us are worthy. Let me go back up to verse 4. He said that he was worthy for whom it should you should do this. Sorry. They said that the man is worthy. The centurion was worthy. And the Bible tells us in verse 5, for he loveth our nation, and he hath built us a synagogue. So it was a good man. He was doing good things. He loved the Jewish people. He can oppress them, but he did not oppress them. Because they were under Roman occupation at the time. And he had 100 soldiers under his command. So he could have oppressed the people, but he chose not to. And he loved the people, and he had a good relationship with them. And here the Bible says, here he built them a synagogue, a house of prayer, a house of worship. Then in verse 6, it said, then Jesus went with them. Praise God. It wasn't because they tell Jesus all of these things why Jesus went. Jesus is a man of compassion. He wasn't influenced by, you know, what they were saying. Praise the Lord. If Jesus didn't want to go, it doesn't matter how much synagogue he built, he still would not have gone. But Jesus chose to go. And when he was now not far from the house, this centurion sent friends to him, saying unto him, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou shouldest enter under my roof. So here the centurion sent another delegation to Jesus. And he said, I am not worthy. What is happening here is that the centurion is recognizing or acknowledging his sin. He's saying, I am not worthy. What he's saying here, I am spiritually bankrupt. And brethren, we need to acknowledge our sins before God. The Bible said if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us away from all unrighteousness. The Bible said he that covereth his sin will not prosper. But he that confess and forsake will have mercy. Don't cover up your sin. If you have sin in your life, run to Jesus. Hallelujah. Call upon him. Cast your heavy burden upon him. Hallelujah. Your sins will be forgiven. He will take them away. He will release you from that heavy burden. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So the centurion said, for I am not worthy that thou shouldest enter under my roof. This man have a lot of humility in him. the common Roman soldier will not bow to a Jewish person and subject himself to a Jewish person, humble himself before a Jewish person in the way that this Roman centurion was humble in himself before the Lord Jesus Christ. It seemed as though there was a move of God going on within his life. You know, and when you look in the Bible, in the New Testament, the Bible mentioned many centurions in New Testament, and you'll see most of them, they have a genuine fear of God. Remember the one who was with Cornelius? He have a genuine fear of God. And here we see that this centurion, he feared the Lord. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. And he acknowledged his sins, that he was not worthy for Jesus to come under his roof. Praise the name of the Lord. Verse 7, wherefore, neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee. And this is not false pride. Somebody will say, well, you know, he was a proud man and he didn't want Jesus to come to his house and he didn't want to go and meet Jesus. It is not false pride we are looking at here. We are looking at somebody that is, humble. We are looking at humility. We are looking at this man, although he was a Roman centurion with 100 soldiers under him, he still sees Jesus as higher than him. He sees Jesus as above him. Jesus didn't have no soldiers. Jesus didn't have any soldiers on earth. You remember when he was attacked, when he was being crucified? He said, don't you know that I have the power to call 10 legions of soldiers? You know how much a legion is? A legion of angels, he said. A legion is 6,000. Jesus had, he said, I have at my disposal the authority to call 10 legions of angels if I wanted. And who know the Old Testament, you'll remember One angel by night came and destroyed 185,000 soldiers, much less to 6,000 angels, how much people they can destroy. But Jesus didn't call anybody to deliver him. Glory be to God, even though he had that at his disposal. So here this man was acknowledging the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's saying that he wasn't worthy for Jesus to come under his roof. And also, he's saying here, wherefore, neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee, but say in a word, and my servant shall be healed. He said, Jesus, I am not worthy to come. I am not worthy for you to come under my roof. And I am not worthy to come to you either. But what I'm saying here, say the word. I acknowledge your power. I know who you are. You are God. You have the power. You can do it. Hallelujah. By a word, you can make it happen. Hallelujah. But say the word. Hallelujah. And my servant shall be healed. This centurion didn't have the Bible. Brethren, this man have faith in God. Today we have the Bible. We don't have no excuse not to trust the Lord, not to have confidence in the word of God. This man is saying here, all Jesus have to do is to speak the word, and his servant is going to be healed. Brethren, we need to stand on the word of God. It is the word of God that is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It is the word of God that is the hammer. The Bible said the word of God, it is the hammer that breaks the rock in pieces. Glory be to God. You might have a mountain before you. You might have a rock before you. But it's the word of God that contains the power to remove it. Hallelujah. There is power in the word of God. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Look what he said in verse 8. For I also am a man set under authority. You know what he's saying? I am a Roman commanding officer. I have my commanding officer who is above me. I have the government is above me. I am under authority, having under me soldiers. So he is under authority. He has people over him. But he has people under him. He has 100 soldiers under him. And what he's saying is, I say unto one, go. Hallelujah. And he goeth. And to another, come. And he cometh. And to my servant, do this. And he does it. And what he's saying here is that I have the authority to make things happen by just speaking a word. And he's saying here, Jesus, I know you have the same authority. You have the same authority to speak a word. The Bible said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Hallelujah. The same was with God in the beginning. Hallelujah. It is the Word. Hallelujah. In the beginning of creation, the Bible said God spoke the Word. Glory be to God. And when he speaks the Word, glory, hallelujah, everything that we have seen today, it came into existence. It is by the power of the Word of God. And what he's acknowledging here is that Jesus' words have power. That distance didn't separate, or distance didn't hinder Jesus from speaking the word. It doesn't matter how far Jesus was away from his servant. Jesus could still speak the word and things can happen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He can say to his servant, go, and they will go. And to another, come, and he cometh. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. Praise God, the power of the word. Verse 9, when Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him. Glory be to God. Jesus, the Bible said when he heard these things, he marveled. And sometimes we might just skip over the word there, marvel. And the word there, marvel, is talking about, like, you know, we'll say, well, I'm shocked. And, you know, you take me off guard. I didn't expect that. And what this is showing us here, when he said Jesus marveled, is showing us that Jesus was a human person. Jesus wasn't just God. Because nothing will take God off guard or get him to be shocked or make him marvel. But Jesus was not just God when he was here on earth. He was a man. He was 100% man, and he was 100% God. That's the reason why the Bible says he marveled. And the reason why this is Jesus' humanity that is manifesting here. It is the humanity of the Lord Jesus Christ that is manifesting there. You remember when Jesus, he went up to that fig tree to see if there was leaves or figs on it. And when he went up, there was no fruit on it. And Jesus cursed the fig tree. It's a part of his humanity. He went there to see. You know, that doesn't mean that he wasn't God. He was fully God. Fully God and fully man. So when he said he marveled, this is a part of his humanity that God is allowing us to see here. He marveled at him and turned him about and said unto the people that followed him, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. Praise the name of the Lord. This man was not a Jew. This man was a Gentile. And the Jewish people have all the laws, and they have all the prophets, and they have the Old Testament scriptures, all of the different benefits that the Lord gave to them. And here Jesus is saying here, glory be to God, somebody who didn't have all of those benefits, somebody who was considered to be a dog, an outcast, glory be to God, he have great faith. And, you know, I remember how many times Jesus will talk about the unbelief that was in the nation of Israel. He said there, I have not found so great faith. No, not in Israel. He couldn't find that kind of faith in Israel. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Brethren, people might consider you to be an outcast. People might consider you to be a reject. But don't let that stop you. All you need to do is to put your faith in the Lord. It's to trust the Lord. Hallelujah. It's to lean upon him. Lean upon him. The Bible said, cast all our cares upon him, for he careth for us. Glory be to God. And they that were sent, returning to the house, found the servant whole that had been sick. Glory be to God. We bless the Lord. Glory to God. Jesus, speak that word. Glory, hallelujah. And the servant, the slave was restored. We thank God when healing comes. Thank God when we are delivered. But brethren, I say to you, when you don't receive your healing, you still have to thank God. You can't give up. Glory be to God. Even though you might be struggling, you could hardly walk. Amen. We have to keep on holding on. As Job said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. You know, Job was doing everything right. Everything right. But everything just turned upside down. God allowed these things to come into his life for his own glory. And sometimes God allowed things to happen to us for his own glory. Why? Because, you know, God is sovereign. I think some Christians don't know and they don't recognize that God is sovereign. And what does it mean when somebody is sovereign? It means when you're sovereign, you can do what you want. You don't have to explain nothing to anybody. A lot of times we have things going on in our lives and we don't have any answer for it. Do you have things in your life that you can't answer? Everybody have things in their lives and they're praying about it and it seems as though there is no answer to it. And the reason why is because God is sovereign and nothing can happen to us as a child of God unless God allow it. Anything that is going on in your life, I don't care how bad it is. Sometimes we blame Satan and we call Satan name and it's Satan and we keep blaming Satan. But brethren, it doesn't matter what is taking place in your life. It means that God allow it to happen and God allow it for a purpose. We may not understand everything here on earth. A lot of the answers that we are looking for, we may not get it here on earth. And I know this is bitter medicine. And this is medicine that is hard to swallow. But I tell you today, the truth of the Word of God, there are some things that we are going through here on earth, and we will not have the answer here. Is when we go in glory, God is going to maybe explain to us You know, some of the things that we are going through here that we didn't receive answers for. Glory be to God. We ought not to worry ourselves, brethren, when there is no answer. When there is no answer, you still have to trust the Lord. You still have to hold on. You still have to keep on running. Still have to keep on fighting the good fight of faith. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In verse 11, and it came to pass the day after that he went into a city called Nain. And many of his disciples went with him, and much people. People was following Jesus. The disciples were following Jesus. To be a disciple, it means that you have to follow. You are a learner. And brethren, we need to become disciples of the Lord. We need to follow him. Jesus said, if any man will come after me, let him take up his cross and follow me. We need to follow him. Where he may lead me, I will go. For I have learned to trust him so. Now when he came nigh to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and much people of the city was with her. So Jesus was with a crowd of people, and here we see that there was this funeral procession that was going on. Lots of people was there, and the Bible said that this was a young man that died, and he was the only son of his mother. And not only that, his mother was a widow. It means that the father passed away too. And, you know, and in those days, when you are a widow, you don't have anybody to protect you. You are very vulnerable. And here the Bible tells us, the Lord Jesus Christ in verse 13, and when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her. Glory be to God. Jesus is touched by the feelings of her infirmity. He's a man of compassion. He understands our pain. He knows our weaknesses. He knows our ups and he knows our downs. Hallelujah. He knows when we are discouraged. He knows when we are weak. Hallelujah. He saw this woman and the Bible said he had compassion. Glory be to God. He moved from his heart on the behalf of this woman. He probably looked at the woman and see that her son, her only son is gone. Her husband is gone. And he knew that, you know, she didn't have any protection, anybody to help her out. And here we see Jesus move with compassion. The Bible said, he said, weep not. Glory be to God. I guess what that means is that don't weep. Help is on the way. And sometimes we need to stop weeping. There's some people, you know, they just keep weeping. And it seems as though all the tears gone. You know, one problem come, and as soon as that problem gone, another one show up on your doorstep. And all you can do is to weep. But the word of God to you today is to weep not. I say to you today, help is on the way. Glory be to God. Jesus said, weep not. And he came and he touched the bearer or whatever the pronunciation there is. That is a piece of board that they have the dead body on. You know, we will call it a stretcher, you know, where four men can hold that piece of board with the handles and they're carrying the body. And Jesus came and he touched that part, the bearer or the body, the board. And it said that they that bear him stood still. So I guess the pallbearers, them, they expect something to happen. They stand up, they were waiting. Amen. Glory be to God. And he said, young man, I say unto thee, arise. Glory, hallelujah. Some of these people must be saying, this man is crazy. This boy is dead for a certain period of time. And here this man is talking to a dead man. Jesus said unto him, young man, I say unto thee, arise. And the I there, it means the I am. It's the I am that is speaking. It is God who is speaking. It is the creation of the heavens, the man who created the heavens and the earth. It is the one that created man from the dust of the ground that is speaking. He said, I say unto thee, arise. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Praise God. And in verse 15, he said, he that was dead sat up and began to speak. Glory be to God. When he heard the command from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible says he sat up and he began to speak. Brethren, those of us who are in Christ, the time will come when the Bible said the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of his archangel, and the trump of God shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise. And those, well, we who are alive and remain unto the end, we shall be caught up to meet him. Brethren, the time will come when our loved ones who gone on before, we cry and we miss them, we mourn their loss. But the time will come when we all will get together. Hallelujah. When we all will be resurrected. Hallelujah. Jesus said to the young man, arise. And he that was dead sat up. I wonder what happened to those guys who were carrying the body. I don't know if they took off. Jesus said, sat up. Glory be to God. And he, in verse 15, and he that was dead sat up. Glory, hallelujah. And began to speak. I guess he's saying, I am not dead, I'm alive. And he delivered him to his mother, give him back to his mother. Give back what the devil tried to stole to his mother. Give her back her protection. He gave her back her future. I believe this boy was supposed to protect his mother, provide for his mother. Jesus, bring him back to life. Give him back to his mother. And there came a fear and all. And they glorified God, saying that a great prophet is risen among us. And that God had visited us. A great prophet. God had visited us. They don't realize it was God who was there. Jesus, he was the Emmanuel. God with us. Glory be to God. And in closing, and this rumor of him went forth throughout all Judah and throughout all the region running about. You know, the rumor of him, or the works of him, the good news of him, the gospel of him, the message of Jesus, it go throughout all the region. Glory be to God. Brethren, the words of Jesus, we need to let it go forth. The message of Jesus, we need to let it go forth. But you know, in the time that we are living in, there are so many hindrances, there are so many barriers, that stumbling block that is out there, that is hindering the message of the Lord Jesus Christ from going forth. There are so many bad examples in the church today that people don't want to hear much about the gospel of Jesus Christ. 25 years ago, there was a revival going on in the church. You know, in our time that we are living, you hardly hear about people getting saved. It's true. I know some people say, well, you shouldn't talk about this. It sounds bad. No, it's the truth. There's not a whole lot of people that is getting saved today. Hallelujah. Not a whole lot of people getting saved. Not a lot of new people getting saved today. What we have going on in the church today is people moving around from church to church. But you don't have a lot of new people getting saved today. But, you know, 25 years ago, we used to have revival. And we have young people coming in the church and young people becoming born again. This thing not happening anymore. And it has to do with the kind of example that people are seeing today. Hallelujah. The ministry that is going on today, so many people using the ministry for their own gain. And people are looking at leaders and seeing what is going on, and this is turning off a lot of people. But in closing, I say to you today, brethren, let us continue to let our light so shine. Glory to God. Lord, we want to thank you for Sister Maureen. Lord, she's just here to give you thanks for your grace, for your mercies towards her. Lord, she's just grateful, forever grateful. I'm forever grateful. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, we pray that your hand of mercies will be extended towards, oh Lord. You will lift her up today in the name of Jesus. God, every burden, every pressure, in the name of Jesus, every worries, Lord, every heartache, Lord, every sadness, Lord, every pain, Lord, where she might be broken in the name of Jesus. God, we pray that your healing oil, the anointing will come. The burden-removing, yoke-destroying power of God will come upon her in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh God, I pray that you'll encourage her where she might be discouraged there, Father God. Wrap your arms of love and mercy. Oh God, hold her in your arms of love today. Wrap her in your arms of love today in the mighty name of Jesus. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Lord, send forth your holy angels, the warring angels of Almighty God, to do battle on her behalf today. Fight her battles and give her the victory, pray today, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. Glory be to God.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Praise God. We want to pray with Sister, with Winsome today. She wants to be saved. She wants to pray that the Lord will come into her heart. She wants to accept Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. Praise the name of the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask you to repeat after me. Lord, I'm a sinner. I repent of my sins. I confess my sins to you. And I ask you to forgive me. Come into my heart. Make me a new person. Lord, I receive the gift of the Holy Spirit that you promised to give to us. In Jesus' name. Praise God. Lord, I want to thank you today for your daughter, Sister Winsome. Glory be to God. We thank you, oh God, that her eyes has been opened. Oh, glory be to God. You bring her to the place of acknowledgement. She see herself, oh God, as a sinner in your sight, Lord. Thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit that you allow to remove the veil from her eyes. God, I pray that you just anoint her in the name of Jesus. God, you'll give her the strength, you'll give her the grace to go forward, to run the race that is set before her. The race is not for the swift, nor the battle for the strong, but for those who endure to the end. Lord, I pray that you surround her. Dispatch your holy angels, the ministering spirits of God, to watch over her, Lord. Strengthen her, Lord Jesus. Oh, God, we bless you. There is rejoicing in heaven over one sinner that repented than over 99 just persons. God, we rejoice today before you on the behalf of your daughter today. Oh, God, who come home. Hallelujah. Oh, glory be to God. She received the call. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. We thank you today that there is power in your word. There is power to save. There is power to deliver. In the mighty name of Jesus. Glory be to God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Lord, I thank you for Sister Arian. Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord, you talk about great faith and you talk about small faith. Lord, where her faith might be small, I pray in Jesus' name, oh God, that that mustard seed faith that you have placed within her, oh God, it will grow in the mighty name of Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. It will grow to become great faith, oh God, where she will be anchored in you, where she will be grounded in you, Lord. Her faith, her eyes will be looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of her faith. Lord, even as she mentioned about healing, Lord, whatever tests that she have coming up, Lord, whatever, oh God, is on her mind where she might be worried, Father, we thank you, oh God, for the power of your word. Whose report shall we believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. The word of the Lord declare, he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by your stripes we are healed. God, we speak the word of God. Even as the word of God was proclaimed today, Father, I pray that the power of your word, oh God, Lord, would cause healing, oh God, to come alive within the life of your daughter today. God, it is not by might, it is not by power, but by your spirit, said the Lord. Father, we are only vessels. We can't do anything. It is the Lord Jesus Christ is the healer. Jesus, you are the great physician, and we call for your help. Lord, I pray that you'll insert your, oh God, healing instrument, Lord. Whatever area of her body need attention, Lord, we pray that you'll minister to her in the mighty name of Jesus. The liquid fire of the Holy Spirit, oh God, will descend upon her, Lord. And you will lift her up, oh God. Lift her from the pit in the name of Jesus. Lift her from the miry clay and put her feet upon that firm foundation. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. We glorify you. We magnify your name today. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, your Son. God, we rejoice before you. Hallelujah. Lord, we rejoice in your presence. God, we thank you for this ministry. We thank you for Straight Gate Ministries. We plead the blood of Jesus Christ over Straight Gate Ministries. We come against the plans of the enemy. We pull down every stronghold in the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, whatever plans the enemy is formalizing towards Straight Gate Ministries, we cancel it by the blood of Jesus Christ. Hide us under the shadow of your wings today. Keep us under your protection, Lord. God, we believe in you. And we stand by the power of your words today. Bless us, O God, as we prepare for this new week. Go with us there, Father. Keep us from harm and danger, accidents and disaster, Lord. Be a fence around us. I pray, O God, for my brother Philemon family in St. Vincent. Lord, as they mourn the loss of my brother, I pray for them in a very special way, Lord, that you'll be, O God, a hedge around them. You will embrace them. You will comfort them. Lord, I thank you because he's in a better place. Oh, God, suffer for 45 years, but he still hold on to you, oh, God. Didn't receive his healing, but glory be to God. He received his deliverance. His deliverance came through death. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who have given us the victory through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thank you for the victory today. Hallelujah. Oh, glory be to God. Hallelujah. Praise God. We bless your name. Take control of everything today, Father. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, your Son. Bless the Lord. Glory to God. The Lord bless thee and keep thee.